Well, he's the man responsible for crafting every federal budget since the coalition won office under Tony Abbott in 2013. By any measure, the biggest hole in next year's budget will be the absence of Finance Minister, Senator Mathias Cormann. I'm pleased to say he joins me now from Canberra. Mate, we'll get to your departure in a moment's time. Great to have you on the show. There's no doubt Australia obviously needs this budget to work. But there's been a lot of focus, I think, on all the talk today about the spending side of the ledger. I want you to talk us about the revenue challenges the government's faced putting this budget together, because I don't think that's been focused on enough in the last 24 hours.
But a very important point you're making there, Peter. Like, on the spending side, we've actually maintained a very strong discipline, and it's quite a contrast to what happened, under the previous government in the wake of the GFC. Yes, we've provided temporary fiscal support on the spending side, but it is very much on a time-limited basis. The spending trajectory within just a few short years is going back to what it was before this crisis, as reflected in the mid-year economic and fiscal outlook for 2019-20. And there's a graph, and apologies for being this specific, but I'm encouraging every Australian to go to Budget Paper 1, which you can download online, page 3-30, there's a graph there which shows the payment trajectory over the forward estimates and over the medium term. And what it shows is that spike in payments before the payments fall back down to essentially the trajectory that we had before. Why is that important? Because the decisions that we've made on the spending side have not baked in structural burdens on the budget bottom line, whereas, in the wake of the GFC, which was incidentally a much smaller crisis in economic terms, a 0.1% contraction in the global economy compared to a 4.5% contraction in the global economy in the context of COVID, 45 times the size of the contraction in the context of COVID. But the challenge that we're facing, you're quite right, is very much on the revenue side. So we've had a 7% contraction in the June quarter this year, and even though the outlook is positive and the outlook is for growth to return, The economic growth trajectory is going to be lower for the next decade or so, and the economy is consistently going to be lower than what it was expected to be, which means that revenue will be less than what it was expected to be. And over the forward estimates, I mean, that is a whopping $227 billion worth of less in tax receipts, not because of any decisions at all, just because of the parameter variations, just because of the economic impact of the COVID recession on our revenue base.
All right, let me just jump in there because, first of all, I'll put that information up on my Facebook page. So I'll go to Budget Paper Book 1. I'll put it up there so people can find that easily because I think that's incredibly important. Two, you're busting the myth because there's a big difference by, a factor of about 40, by my maths, just listening to you there, between what happened in terms of the contraction under the GFC to the economic contraction, far worse under this COVID crisis. But also Labor, they like to pretend that somehow tax cuts and spending increases are all the same. But of course, tax cuts is just you not sending enough money or more money to Canberra and instead government letting you keep that money in your pocket. Now, Labor don't like giving people back their money, of course. That's a big deal. But this is Australians keeping their money when they need it to work hard for them at the moment.
Well, I mean, precisely right. I mean, income tax relief is not a spending measure by government. It's an income tax cut. It leaves people with more of their own hard-earned money in their pocket, which is good for them, through this period. But it's also good for the economy because it does help boost aggregate demand. I mean, we are bringing forward income tax relief very much focused on the low and middle income earners level, and we do expect that most of that money will ultimately find its way into consumption and will help boost economic growth domestically that way. But, I mean, in the end, every individual Australian makes their own decisions as to what they want to do with their money. And if individual Australians want to save some of that money, there's nothing wrong with that. I mean, that improves their financial position. It no doubt improves their feeling of confidence in the context of whatever headwinds might come their personal way. So this proposition by some commentators that somehow an income tax cut is no good from an economic point of view because people might save some of that money, I just don't agree with. I mean, I think,
no, yes, I don't agree
I mean, there will be a lot of consumption, But, I mean, there's nothing wrong with people actually building up a little fiscal buffer of their own for a rainy day.
Just on that point too, when I went through all the numbers again this morning, so much of the spending in the budget on the expenditure side, as I said, not the revenue side, is all temporary. It's designed to get people back into their jobs, incentivise business to spend themselves on capital and plant, or to hire people that perhaps wouldn't be ready necessarily to pick up now until the business is up and going better. So it's temporary spending, as opposed to what you inherited back in 2013, which is recurrent spending. That's spending, I mean, this is for people's benefit at home, baked in to the budget for years and years in advance, really hard stuff to unwind. Now, I remember sitting in meetings with you when you went through line by line by line, looking for 50 million or 100 million, all to add up to getting the budget back into the black. Is the government up for that again when you go? And two, is Australia up for the conversation that we tried to have back in 2014, that we didn't sort of get, I think, done comprehensively enough, Mathias, that we are prepared to stop some of the things we do, that we will stop some of the recurrent spending, that we are living beyond our means?
Well, look, I think that we got more, looking back, we got more done in these first 6 years than perhaps people realised at the moment. The budget bottom line improved by about $250 billion over a decade as a result of the spending controls and the significant focus on budget repair that we initiated in that 14-15 budget. We didn't get everything up, but we got a lot locked in, and a lot of our savings measures at the time were structural. I mean, they started low and slow and built over time. And, after a seven-year period, I mean, some of these early decisions actually are paying very significant dividends. The next point, I mean, in this budget, most of the fiscal support into the economy is actually on the tax side and not on the spending side of the equation, in the form of lower taxes or tax incentives. I mean, and I'll give you just one example. I mean, the opportunity for businesses with a turnover of up to $5 billion to be able to fully expense any investment in their future growth and success, in terms of any investment into assets, into their future growth and success. I mean, that is something that will lower the tax revenue as a result of a decision by about $26.7 billion over the forward estimates. But the cost over the medium term is actually just $3 billion. So the cost from now to 2030-31 is $3 billion, because a lot of that revenue gets recouped once the business is no longer able to climb those deductions down the track, and they are going to be more profitable compared to the situation they otherwise would have been in, and so the taxable income is going to be higher down the track. So we're bringing forward the deduction, we're bringing forward the cash flow support to business. Yes, we're taking the fiscal hit, but in terms of the structural impact on the bottom line over time, we will actually be able to recoup a lot of that money back at the time when the economy recovers, businesses recover, and those businesses are in a stronger, healthier position.
Those profits are coming in. I have to leave it there, but I'm going to ask you on camera, so you can't refuse me, if we can have a chat before you depart Canberra. What I think has been, well, an extraordinary life for you to come to Australia when, within 10 years, end up in the federal parliament, but your legacy to Mathias Cormann as finance minister. So can I have you back at another time?
I'll be back, I promise.
Terrific.